Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nicholas Lapis, and this is the this is the system validation review for the attitude control and deployment concept ACDC. So I'd like to introduce our assistant project manager, Scott. So today we'll talk about the design team organization, then we'll go into the mission concept, then we'll go into the system of systems definition, and then both of our systems, definitions and validations, then into our system of systems validation, then we'll go over configuration management, and then some programmatics. So for a design team layout, we have a project manager, and then two teams, both with a team lead and two team members, and then we have two system integrators and an assistant project manager for a total of 10 people. So at the beginning of the year, we were tasked with designing a project that can determine and control its attitude in order to launch different sized CubeSats towards a target individually of each other. And it has to be mounted with a three-axis gimbal system. So the different payloads that we can put into our system are a 1U, 2U, and 3U CubeSat. And a 1U CubeSat is 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters, and it weighs about 1 kilogram, and that's the upper limit. The 2U CubeSat is 20 centimeters in length, and it weighs 2 kilograms. And the 3U CubeSat is 30 centimeters in length, and it weighs about 3 kilograms. So for our first mission configuration, we would load ACDC with 3 1U CubeSats. For our second mission configuration and our third mission configuration, we'd load ACDC with a 1U and a 2U, but we'd launch them in different orders. For our fourth mission configuration, we would load ACDC with a 3U CubeSat. So this is a top-down view of our mission layout. So what we have is ACDC in the middle of a ring with an inner radius of 2.75 meters and an outer radius of 3.25 meters. And the target would be selected as a sector of that ring that has a total area of 3,750 centimeters squared. So this is a simulation of our first mission configuration, which is the launching of 3 1U CubeSats. And so to start the mission, we would flip the power switches on the front of ACDC, and it would start to spin itself up to between 0.5 and 1 revolution per second about all three body axes simultaneously. So once that attitude, or once that angular velocity is reached about all three, then it starts to spin down in order to orient itself into the correct attitude to enable it to launch the first CubeSat. As you'll see, when it launches the first CubeSat from the system, it exerts a torque that it has to overcome in order to launch the second, and then again in order to launch the third. Once the third CubeSat is deployed from the system, it shuts off and the mission is over. So now I'd like to bring up Adam Scott to talk about our system of systems definition.
Thank you, Nick. Hello, my name is Adam Scott. I'm the assistant project manager, and I'll be going over our system of systems definition. So first of all, I'd like to introduce our integration team, Ryan Burns and Jesse Guys. So first of all, I'll be showing our design structure tree, which basically breaks our design down into systems and subsystems. So at the top of the design structure tree, where we have our ACDC system of systems, and that gets broken down into two systems beneath that, gimbal system and satellite system. So here's a picture of our fully fabricated system of systems. As you can see, we have our gimbal on the bottom and our satellite mounted within the gimbal. So here's our design structure tree for just the gimbal system. It has four subsystems beneath it: the gimbal base, the outer ring, the inner ring, and the bearing subsystem. So here's a picture of just the gimbal system by itself. We have the gimbal base on the bottom, which supports the outer ring, which then supports the inner ring inside. And those three together will allow our three-axis rotation. So here's a picture of just our gimbal base by itself to show the bearings. So there's two bearings, one on each side, and there's also bearings for each ring, and those are what allow these spinning. So here's a picture of how our satellite gets mounted within the inner ring of the gimbal. So the satellite is on the left over here, the inner ring is over here on the right, and connecting them is a bearing shaft made of steel and two collars with set screws in it to keep it tight. There's one on each side of the satellite. So here's the design structure tree for just the satellite system. It has the satellite structure, the electrical subsystem, attitude control, CubeSat launcher, and attitude determination. So here's a CATIA generated graphic of just the satellite structure subsystem. So we have an aluminum frame, which forms the backbone of the satellite, and two aluminum mounting plates, which allow attachment points for all the other subsystems, and tank brackets on both the top and bottom mounting plate for our tanks, which I'll go over later. So now that the satellite structure subsystem is hidden as a wireframe, all the colored components consist of our electrical subsystem. So we have an Arduino Mega, which serves as our microprocessor, a LiPo battery to power everything, the relay, six solenoid valves, two on the top, two on the bottom, which allow our thrusters to be pulsed, and a power on and off switch. Here's a rotated view of the satellite to show underneath the bottom mounting plate. We have three electronic rotary latches, which assist with our CubeSat deployment, which I'll go over later. Now that the electrical subsystem is hidden, you can see our attitude control subsystem, which first of all consists of two compressed gas tanks, 4,500 PSI. Those gas tanks feed into a regulator, which drops down the pressure from 4,500 PSI to about 180 PSI. And then that gas tank feeds into the solenoid valves, which then feed in to our microthrusters mounted around the satellite, and then we have 12 of them total. Here's a rotated view of the backside of the satellite to see our solenoid valves. The hosing connects into them with T-joints, which then goes to the microthrusters. So here's our CubeSat launch subsystem. So it's mounted between the two mounting plates. We have removable divider plates shown in blue here, and the purpose of those is to allow our different CubeSat configurations to be mounted within the CubeSat launcher. We have retainer doors inside each cell for so if we had three 1Us, one door would be holding in one 1U, and those are what keep the CubeSats in place, and those get locked into the electronic rotary latches on the bottom of the satellite. And finally, we have our attitude determination subsystem. We have solar panels mounted around the satellite, which determine our sun vector, because this would be run outside, and we'd be able to determine our sun vector. And the two IMUs inside the satellite, which are hidden in this view, would determine our gravity vector, and those two vectors together would allow us to determine our attitude. And finally, we have our fully assembled satellite system. So we have 12 microthrusters in total, 14 solar panels, and two gimbal attachment points. Now I'd like to introduce Gavin Hofer, who will be talking about our gimbal system.
Thank you, Adam. My name is Gavin Hofer. I'm the gimbal team lead for Imperium Space, and I'll be talking about the gimbal system today. I'd like to introduce our team members, Drew Duketta and Jacob Turner. So the gimbal system is made up of three main sub-assemblies. We have the gimbal base there, the outer ring, and the inner ring. Together, these interface to physically support the satellite and provide it with a 3-degree of freedom rotation. The gimbal system has one system level requirement, and that is that it shall withstand all dynamic loading while the satellite has an angular speed of greater than or equal to 1 revolution per second about all axes. The reason we chose this value is that in our primary objectives, the satellite has to be raised to an angular speed of between 0.5 and 1 revolution per second about all axes, and we wanted the gimbal system to withstand all these loads throughout that entire range, so that it will not break during the mission. For the gimbal base shall have no translation or rotation during the mission. As you can see, we don't want it to we don't want it to slide in any direction or rotate either about its z-axis or tip over. All these things could either cause damage or unforeseen consequences in terms of attitude control. For the outer ring subsystem, it shall have an inner radius that is greater than or equal to 0.355 meters. The reason for this requirement is that we designed the satellite and the inner ring, the outer dimensions of those before the outer ring, so that we could, so it has to be able to be large enough to accommodate those other subassemblies. And also the center of mass of the outer ring shall be offset by less than or equal to 3 millimeters with respect to the axis of rotation of the outer ring. And this value is determined based on simulation. If the offset is too great, then the thrusters can't accommodate, and you end up using too much fuel and running the risk of mission failure due to the tension effects. The requirements of the inner ring are similar to the outer ring. It has to be greater than or equal, the inner radius shall be greater than or equal to 0.25 meters. Again, this is to accommodate the satellite. It has to be large enough for the satellite to fit inside. And the center of mass of the inner ring shall be less than or equal to 3 millimeters from the center of rotation. And this was also determined using simulation. The difference is that in this case, we're using center of rotation rather than axis of rotation, because the inner ring rotates about multiple axes, while the outer ring only rotates about one axis. And then for the bearings shall allow 360 degree rotation of the interfacing structures in either direction. In order for the satellite to rotate freely, the bearings have to allow that unimpeded. It can't just go to a certain angle and stop, or only rotate in one direction. The bearings shall apply dynamic torque, frictional torque, that is less than or equal to 0.5 newton meters. This was determined based on simulation. If the frictional torque applied by the bearings is too high, either the thrusters can't accommodate, they can't overcome that friction, or they will use too much fuel and run the risk of mission failure. And then the bearings shall withstand radial loads that are greater than or equal to 400 newtons and axial loads that are greater than or equal to 200 newtons. These values were also determined based on simulation. We estimated the maximum radial and axial loads that will be applied to any set of bearings throughout the mission, and we applied a factor of safety of 1.5 to these values. With that, I'd like to pass it off to Drew Takeda to talk about gimbal rings validation tests.
Thank you, Gavin. Hi, my name is Drew Takeda. I'll be going over the gimbal rings validation test. So in order to validate our first requirement of the inner radius for both the outer and inner ring, we had to conduct an inner radius test. For this test, we just had to measure the distance from the center of the flange plate to the inner part of the ring, shown in the figure behind me. As far as the results for this test, we found that the inner radius for the outer ring was 0.40 meters, and that the inner ring had an inner radius of 0.33 meters. Both of these radii validates the first requirement for the outer and inner ring. The theoretical results, we designed the outer ring to have an inner radius of 0.394 meters, and the inner ring to have an inner radius of 0.33 meters. So some differences between the outer ring results we found could be due to the tolerancing when the aluminum tubing were cut, so the during the fabrication process, as well as the precision in the measuring device. We had to use a tape measure because we didn't have calipers available that were large enough to measure that distance. Now for the second requirement, the center mass offset, we had to conduct a balance test. So this is the first balance test that we conducted. This is for the flange mount axis. And for this test, we inserted bearing shafts into the flange mount collars, and we placed them on two test rails, and we allowed the ring to settle out. And we placed an electronic scale under the side that tended to be heavier, so you get a force reading on that. The bearing mount axis test setup was similar. However, we inserted the bearing shafts into the bearing this time. And for the z-axis test setup, we held the rings vertically and held an electronic scale on the side that tended to be heavier. As far as the results for this test, we found the center mass offset was 0 millimeters from the center of rotation, but this was achieved by taping washers around the rings. And we were able to determine how large the washers needed to be and where to place them based on the sum of moments equation along with the electronic scale readings. And this validates our second requirement for the outer and inner rings. As far as the theoretical results, we designed the rings to be symmetrical about all axes, so that the center mass offset would be 0 millimeters. As far as the differences between the two results, before adding washers around the rings, this could be due to the welds weren't exactly even throughout, as well as the paint. Also, for the components of each of the parts, they weren't cut exactly the same size. As far as potential problems for this test setup, the friction between the bearing shafts as well as the test rails, they could have been pretty high. We could have reduced this by inserting the bearing shafts into another bearing, so allow it to rotate a little more freely. Also, the scale can only measure to a tenth of a gram. This is just the precision of the measuring device. And for the z-axis, the reading could have been inaccurate because the electronic scale was held by hand, and we couldn't apply force, or we couldn't keep the scale steady. But this was just an estimate of the offset center mass for the z-axis. I'll hand it off to Jacob Turner to talk about the bearing validation test.
All right, thank you, Drew. I'm Jacob Turner, and I'll be talking about the bearing validation test. So all six bearings were first press fit into their bearing plates before any tests were done with them. And the requirements that we were going to test was the radial load of 400 newtons, which is the equivalent of 90 pounds, an axial load of 200 newtons, 40 or 45 pounds, and a frictional torque exertion of less than 0.5 newton meters. And this applies while under the either axial or radial load. For the radial load friction test, we made this setup you see here. And we applied a 40 pounds to one side of the bearing shaft and 50 pounds to the other side. This creates the net 90 pounds of radial load on the bearing. And that 10 pound difference causes a torque of the 10 pounds times the radius of the bearing shaft, which is the equivalent of 0.35 newton meters if we do the unit conversions. And the bearing shaft underwent a steady angular acceleration under the 0.35 newton meters, and it needed to undergo some steady angular acceleration under no more than 0.5 newton meters to be validated. So the axial load friction test, 45 pounds of axial load was applied to the bearing with no visible or detectable failure of the bearing itself. And we implemented just a hand measurement tension scale on the moment arm, where we knew the distance from the center of the bearing shaft to where the force is applied. And by slowly increasing the force of the tension scale, we can determine how much torque is required to cause rotation of the bearing itself. And there are some variables that come into play in terms of the hand measurement and the angle at which you pull the scale. We conducted this test a couple of three times and found that the maximum applied torque required was never greater than 0.06 newton meters, which surpasses our requirement by a pretty large margin of the 0.5 newton meters. So all requirements of the bearing subsystem are validated from our test results, and in the future, to improve the test results, we could measure the frictional torque at higher angular velocities to get a better idea of how it changes over the range of angular velocities that we experience. And I'd like to welcome Consuelo to talk about the satellite system.
Thank you, Jacob. My name is Consuelo Wells, and I'm the satellite system team lead. I'd like to take a moment to introduce the rest of the satellite team, John Lowe, and Oliver Maheda. And what I'd like to go over is the satellite system, its requirements, and how we numerically validated those requirements. So behind me is a picture of the satellite system. The three callouts represent the three types of requirements that we had for the system. shall raise its angular speed to between 0.5 and 1 RPS in each axis. This one was numerically validated using a Simulink model, and those design values are listed on the right. To get a better idea of those rotational axes, here's a picture of the satellite offset, such as this, to give you an idea. And the second set of requirements are the error and roll pitch and yaw of the position of the satellite. These shall be less than or equal to 40 degrees, 15 degrees, and 7 degrees, respectively. And these were also numerically validated using the Simulink simulation. The last set of requirements have to do with the launcher. Behind me is a picture of the launcher with three 1U CubeSats loaded inside to give you an idea of what that looks like. And those requirements are that the satellite shall launch CubeSats to between 2.75 and 3.25 meters away from the system. We numerically validated these using spring math and hand calculations. And to get a better idea of what that looks like, we have a diagram with a CubeSat being launched to its target, that distance of 2.75 to 3.25 meters away from the system. And now I'd like to introduce John Lowe to go over the CubeSat deployment and hosing validation tests.
All right, thank you, Consuelo. My name is John. I'm going to be going over the CubeSat deployment and our hosing validation test. So, for the CubeSat deployment test setup, the way we performed this test is we loaded the three 1U CubeSats into the satellite and then carried the satellite outside in an effort to minimize the damage to both our system and all surrounding equipment and reduce the chance of harming any individuals that may be nearby in the event that something went wrong. The CubeSats were then manually released using the manual switches on our electronic rotary latches. So the numerical results that we got for this test, we expected to get an exit velocity on the CubeSats of 4.6 meters per second, and this would send our CubeSats approximately 3 meters in a horizontal direction. We used projectile motion equations to come up with these results. So the actual results of the test, the first CubeSat barely left the launcher, and the second CubeSat didn't leave the launcher at all. So a brief failure analysis. The primary belief as to why this happened is that a torque was applied to the CubeSats while they were inside the launcher and leaving the launcher. This is resulting from the launcher being slightly too large and our tolerances being slightly loose. So the torque caused the CubeSat to twist just a little bit, and then the edge, instead of sliding along, was then scraping against the inside of the launcher, significantly reducing the energy it was receiving while it was traveling. Transitioning into our hosing test, here you can see several of the components in our propulsion system. We have our micro thrusters, two different kinds of hosing, and a compressed air tank in this image. So for the setup, we connected the tanks, regulators, valves, micro thrusters, all using their respective hosing. The regulator and tanks were then opened, allowing air to flow through, and then the solenoids were individually pulsed, allowing air to continue through their respective micro thrusters. The numerical results of this test were based on the manufacturer ratings for the hosing. So we have two different kinds. For the tanks to regulator, due to the higher pressure, we have hosing rated to 6,895 kilopascals, whereas the rest of the system uses hosing rated to 1,475 kilopascals. So results of the test, the hosing did not rupture. This is a very good thing because as it means our hosing can definitely withstand the pressures that it will be experiencing during a mission. However, we did not cycle the hosing through multiple mission lifetime or mission cycles. This is due to simply the time it takes to refill the air tanks every single time that they're completely drained. We did not have the time to fulfill the requirements set for that. But based on manufacturer rating and the tests we have performed, we do believe it to be safe for further use. And now I'd like to hand it off to Oliver Nahara to go over our air tanks, regulator, and micro thruster validation.
Good afternoon. My name is Oliver Nahara, and I'll be discussing the validation of the air tanks, the regulator, and the micro thrusters. The test setup and the numerical results for the air tanks are really simple. The air tanks had only needed the air tank itself to be tested, and the numerical results were posted on the tank. The number of inches for us was the 4,500, representing how many PSI it had. The test only required that the tank stay pressurized for at least 6 minutes, which represents twice the allowed mission time, and both of our tanks were validated when they remained pressurized for 2 days until we used them for the next test. The regulator test had a pressurized tank connected to the input of the regulator and the output of the regulator connected to a pressure gauge. The numerical results of the regulator came from the manufacturer specification sheet, which stated that the pressure could be adjusted to between 0 psi and 225 psi. We validated the regulator when we were able to use an Allen key or a hex wrench to adjust the pressure to 180 psi. The microthruster test setup had a scale with an upward facing microthruster to measure the thrust. It had a solenoid valve to open and close the flow, and it was connected to the regulator, which was still set at 180 psi. However, this test setup included an added force to the thrust measurement, which was due to pressure in the hose. So to find out this force, we conducted a closed flow test, which used a plug microthruster. And using superposition, once we had known first both of the forces, we'd use it to find the thrust of just the microthruster. The numerical results of the microthrusters were based off of the design, which was to exert 2 newtons of force with a chamber pressure of 180 psi. And due to the high ratio of the throat to the tubing diameters, we were able to mitigate pressure loss through the hosing, and thus all 12 of our microthrusters were validated. And now I'd like to bring up Ryan Burns, who will discuss the system-to-system validation.
Thank you, Oliver. My name is Ryan Burns. I'm going to go over our system-to-system validation. So first, the system-to-system requirements. So the satellite's rotation velocity at mission commencement shall equal to zero. The system-to-system shall be able to raise its angular speed to a value that's greater than or equal to 1/2 revolution per second and less than or equal to 1 revolution per second. The system-to-system shall be able to launch CubeSats between a range of 2.75 and 3.25 meters. And the system-to-system shall be able to complete its missions, primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary missions within 180 seconds each. All right, we've heard these requirements previously in our presentation. However, this helps prove the required existence of our systems within our system of systems. All right, now the design metrics that correspond with our requirements. So the AC-DC system shall raise its angular speed between a range of 1/2 to 1 revolution per second. So this is validated numerically through our Simulink simulation model, where on our x-axis we're able to rotate at 0.55 revolutions per second, our y, 0.7 revolutions per second, and then our z, 0.72 revolutions per second. Now the spring launch distance design metric, which says that we have to launch between a distance of 2.75 and 3.25 meters. This is numerically validated through hand calculations with a launch angle of 45 degrees, and we target 3 meters. And then our system of systems mission time design metric. This says that our primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary missions must be completed in 180 seconds each. With our current simulation, we're able to prove that our primary mission will be successful in 46 seconds, our secondary and tertiary in 39 seconds, and then our quaternary in 34 seconds. Again, numerically validated through our Simulink simulation. At this time, I'd like to bring up Jesse Ives to go over our system validation, finish it up, and to introduce our configuration management.
Hello, my name is Jesse Ives, and today I'll be discussing the system-to-system validation, as well as the configuration management for our system. So starting out with the system-to-system validation, the way we would test that is we would run it through four mission cycles, each of them representing one of the required mission configurations. So the angular velocity requirement would be satisfied by looking at the IMU data we gather during these missions and verifying that we reach between 0.5 and 1 revolution per second during the spin-up phase of the mission. Next, the CubeSat launch distance requirement will be validated by checking whether or not each CubeSat landed within the desired target area 3 meters away during the mission run cycle. And then finally, the mission time requirement would be validated if the last CubeSat landed within the target area within 180 seconds. Now, unfortunately, we weren't able to finish all of the fabrication and lower level design testing, so the system of systems was not validated. Now moving on to the configuration management. So our configuration management gives us a design history of the project. What you can see here is the product structure tree. Each of the boxes on the product structure tree represents a subassembly, and the product structure tree breaks down the system of systems into subassemblies, which when put together form the system of systems assembly. So each subassembly has its associated bill of materials, as you can see here, and the bill of materials lists all the subassemblies and parts which go into making the subassembly. So each of these has a document associated with it, either another bill of materials, as here, or as you can see up behind me, a part drawing, this one being for our thrusters. In addition to that, each subassembly has an associated assembly drawing. And what the assembly drawing does is it gives you a step-by-step process by which to assemble the parts and subassemblies listed in the bill of materials to make the subassembly. So through the product structure tree, you have direct access to all of the design documents you need in order to successfully build our system of systems. Now I'd like to hand it back to Nicholas Lapis to go over programmatics and conclude our presentation.
Thank you, Jesse. Now for some programmatics. So at the beginning of the year, we were given $1,600 for our project, 50 of which we set aside for our preliminary design mockup. Another 50 for our critical design mockup, and another 50 for our program administration, as well as $240 for a contingency fund just in case things go wrong in fabrication. So, over the course of the year, we spent approximately 4,676 hours on this project, which breaks down into around 467 hours per person, which breaks down further into 15 and a half hours per person per week over the course of this entire year. And as you can see by the pie chart, about a third of the hours were spent in professional development, which is time spent on the project in class. Another third were spent in engineering, which is time spent on the project out of class, working on the design aspect. And then another large chunk of our hours were spent in administration, which is time spent on documentation and presentations. And then also there's management, which is time spent by project managers. And then technical hours are hours spent in the machine shop where we're actually fabricating. And then there's also holiday hours, which are hours spent on the project during holidays. So, now into some lessons learned during the project. So as you can see up on the screen, there's this picture is a picture of our ring. And what we had to do is we had to weld together the tubes, and then we had to weld the gusset plates on. And so one of the issues that came up is with all of the setup, with all of our fabrication, we didn't actually take the time that it takes to actually set up everything up into account, which is actually more significant than actually just welding it together. So what we had to do for this is when we welded the tubes together, we there's all the welds, and you need the flat surface in order to weld the gusset plates on. And so we had to end up taking the, waiting for it to cool, bringing it over to the table and grinding off some of the welds so that we had a flat surface to weld more stuff onto it. Mm-hmm. So it ends up taking about 3 times longer than you expect. So little things like that happened during the project. In order to get these side panels on the satellite, we had to grind off a lot of the welds around the sides of the satellite frame. And then also in this picture, you can see a picture of our launcher being assembled. This lesson of fabrication taking longer than expected and little things arising all the time actually would have crippled our project, and we wouldn't actually have a system to show. It wouldn't be done fabricating, because if it wasn't for this welding table and machine shop, because it makes things so quick to align and be able to weld it all together. So another lesson learned is that you need to protect your solar cells. We built solar panels, and we put them on the satellite a little prematurely when we were still taking the satellite out of the gimbal, and we were still putting things into the satellite. And what that ended up causing is when we were tightening things, we'd accidentally slightly touch the solar cells, and if you touch it at all, it just breaks, it just shatters. Mm-hmm. And so we had to rebuild them. Mm-hmm. And then also, the picture right here, on your right, we had a little design change because we had these little square tabs with big holes in them that we were going to weld to the front of the launcher. And we found out through this entire fabrication process is that if we try to weld those little tabs onto the front of the launcher, it was going to cause issues where the tabs would be deformed, and also some of the weld would go over into the hole. So we wouldn't actually be able to, their purpose was to hold the divider plates in the satellite launcher. So it wasn't going to work, so we had to change it to an angle bracket. So this is another little design change that we had to go through. We learned from this that you can't overlook any aspect when you're in the design process and in the fabrication process of your project. You can't, if you look over any little aspect of it, it'll come back to bite you. And in this case, we actually had a little tab on the side of here that would lock into a latch, and that would hold the entire force of our springs and our satellite. And so when we had it fabricated, we looked at it and we were like, oh, no, I don't think that would work. So we tested it and under a lesser load than it would actually experience in the actual system, and it snapped off, so we had to redesign it. And so I'd like to thank everyone listed above for their contribution to the project, especially Dr. Julio Benavides and Dr. Matthew Haslam. And also I'd like to give a really big thanks to the machine shop technicians, because our project is extremely fabrication heavy. So this is a demonstration that we actually did last night, because we finished some of the electrical. And this is the launcher's firing to control the attitude of the system. We're actually pretty excited about that. even though it's just a little thing, it demonstrates that it works, and we weren't actually able to successfully perform any of our missions, which was sad, but we were able to do little things like this. We also have another video of them not pulsing, but just a full open to rotate satellite. It spins it up a little bit. So then that was just with the solenoid valves open slightly, just for a little short amount of time, just to demonstrate that the thrusters actually provide enough thrust to spin the system up. So then on the next slide we also have a test of our launcher where, as we said before, we had some issues with the tolerancing and the satellite wasn't able to reach its target. But this is a video of the satellite launching from the system. Okay, so like was said earlier, there was some tolerancing issues. The satellite actually was able to drop slightly in the launcher, and this was one of the issues, where the spring wasn't aligned with the center of mass of the CubeSat, so it exerted a torque, that torque, and that torque caused a lot more friction than we expected, and took a lot of energy from the system. So now, I'd like to invite the rest of my team up for any questions you may have. So the error in roll specifically is so large because when you're actually in launch orientation, if the system rolls at all, like to its side, it doesn't actually affect the, it doesn't change the position and orientation of the launcher. So it affects the position of where it lands slightly, but it doesn't actually affect.
Slide 65. So you noted that it was a failure test, and you learned from the failure. You got a real good root cause analysis, or this initial first cut root cause analysis of blood. But I noticed you jumped right in from that to talk about the next test. Is there any effort at trying to make corrections in the testing system?
Unfortunately, because of the time that it took to fabricate the system, we ran out of time, and all of these tests were pretty last minute. So we weren't able to fix anything afterwards. We were just testing to see if our designs worked.
Okay. Slide 84. Same question as before. You have some really large design requirements. Where are these coming from? Were they mandated by the project, or were they determined some other way?
You're talking about the 180 seconds? So the 180 seconds were mandated by the project, and then Gavin Hofer, he is the mastermind behind the control system in Simulink, and based on putting in the dynamics that the system would experience and the force that we would be able to provide, we found out that it wouldn't take nearly as long as the requirements stated to complete the mission, so it was never an issue to complete it in time.
Okay, so it's custom to the problem. So, pass to us.
Okay. Let's see. First, I guess, let me introduce myself. Unless you were sitting in the previous presentation. Okay. Les Kyocho, NASA Johnson Space Center. Afraid to fail, because it's important. was, I guess, maybe a little bit on some advice on presentation and how things are structured a little bit. At first, when you jumped in and you gave your overview, I wasn't quite sure what the true objectives were of what you were trying to accomplish. So it wasn't clear to me whether you're, in effect, building an emulator of a CubeSat launcher. It didn't become clear to me until you got later in the presentation. So I was a little confused up front. So I would probably suggest maybe spending a few more slides at the beginning explaining exactly what you're trying to accomplish before you jump into the details. That's just a kind of a suggestion. No problem. Let's see. The testing on the center of mass, you pointed out that there were these inaccuracies that you ran into in terms of the scale, doing things by hand and everything, but yet you arrived at a perfect measurement, so I was a little confused by that.
So we could talk a little bit into that. I'll hand it off to Drew.
Yeah, so as far as to the tolerance that we could measure, we couldn't detect any center of mass offset. Before we had started balancing them with the watchers and things, we detected a center of mass offset of about like 0.3 millimeters. But those were just some of the potential causes for inaccuracies, especially with by hand.
Also when you use things like spring scales.
Yeah.
Analog spring scales. It's tough to get exact measurements too. Yeah, just be aware of that. Since you are dealing with rotations, you put up specs that are associated with roll, pitching, and all orientations. I always find it's important to have a coordinate system diagram somewhere so that every satellite will have its own notion of what roll, pitch, and all might be in terms of what the primary axes are. So that's something I would suggest in terms of presentation. Jacob already touched the big one on retesting. That's important. Let's see. I'm trying to hurry up here. So you talked about for your spring launch distance calculations using hand calcs. And you model those using projectile motion, which I understand. But what about the actual interaction of just modeling a simple spring-based system to give you that initial, your initial velocity, your kick load off of a spring system? Is there any of that type of modeling done at all?
Yes, and I can hand it off to John Lowe to talk about that.
Okay.
So this goes into a little bit about how we selected those specific springs. We used the general height and position of the satellite in the gimbal to find out approximately what our exit velocity would need to be. And based on that number and the mass of the CubeSat and the plate behind the CubeSat, we then used energy equations, just simple spring energy equations started with 1/2 mv squared, and from that found the kinetic energy required, and then translated that into how much potential energy we need stored in our springs.
Sure. Okay, so as part of those calculations, I'm glad you answered that way. From the transition from your potential to your kinetic energy, how did you model any sort of losses that would be attributed to friction, which obviously doesn't apply here? Or any other losses?
The only loss we directly accounted for was friction. We used the coefficient of static friction for aluminum on aluminum for that and factored that in and found that these springs were still acceptable for that. The main problem is the design for the launcher was supposed to be full contact on all sides, so it's just supposed to be sliding along and not have the ability for the CubeSats to rotate in the launcher and cause problems that way.
Okay, and you already pointed out in your presentation that there was, by decreasing the tolerances on that, making it tighter, that would help avoid with that misalignment that you ran into. So, okay, all right, very good. I think that's all I have. I'll go ahead and hand it off to my JPL colleague over here. Thank you, good job.
Thanks, Austin. My name is Owen Cindy. I'm a grad at Nova 4 in Maine, same semester as Julio. So I get all my dirty secrets from him. good job. I'm a JPL working as a software systems architect at the moment. A couple of comments. One, you guys interchange SI and English units, and sometimes use both. I think because some folks were like, you know, let's say kilograms, but people might not be comfortable with say pounds. But when you show both for a single measurement, actually, it's not a precise conversion in significant figures. And so when you're testing, like I wouldn't have been sure I tested the kilos or the pounds. And so the recommendation is the standard industry practice. You pick one set of units, English or SI, and you stick to those. You have your requirements to them, you fill your design to them, and you do your testing to them. Now, even if it's convenient, it makes sense to show the others, you just don't do that. Maybe you do that internally for yourself, but it's a big no-no because then you have two extra requirements, one in SI and one in English, and I don't know, you need to pass one and not the other based on your tolerances and measurements. So be careful with that. So convenience here does not excuse good system engineering practices. The other comment I'd say, everybody learns this the hard way. Need to have schedule margin for procurement, for manufacturing, for testing, retesting, including anomalies. Same goes, of course, with all your resources, costs, and expendables like propellant, et cetera. So I'm glad that you guys learned that lesson the hard way here, rather than going out in the industry and learning it there, when it's a lot more expensive and bigger things are on the line. And a couple of questions. Was the Gimbal system designed based on a historic reference design, or is it something that you guys came up with on your own?
So I'm going to pass this off to the Gimbal team lead to talk into this question.
This is something that we came up with on.
Okay. Did you look at historical designs at all to help?
We looked at a few. We didn't really end up using anything too similar to anything that we found. We found some information from like previous projects that said that like having the outer ring be horizontal is generally that makes it more stable, easier to accommodate than having it be vertical.
Okay.
But yeah, other than that, like, we pretty much just designed it.
Okay. In the same spirit, was the CubeSat launcher design based on existing, or was it a new design that you guys came up with back here?
So the CubeSat launcher, we looked at a lot of different designs in the past, but then we ended up coming up with our own design too. We took in a lot of different ideas from other ones, and then we combined them into our laundry.
Okay. So I think the general lesson learned that you might have missed there is sometimes reinventing the wheel is not what you want to focus on. Actually, this is a philosophy that's applied by SpaceX as opposed to the extreme. They will not reinvent the wheel in anything if they can use a historically like a 60-year-old proven technology or manufacturing technique or simple analytical software solutions. So I commend you on trying new things and coming up unique because you need that creativity, but sometimes you have to do the trade-off between is it worthwhile to, where do I need that creativity and uniqueness, and where should I go with that old and tried and proven? And so maybe, in your case, maybe if you focus on design that had already been proven, maybe the other system could have had more time and attention. Again, it's all about resources and all about prioritization. So I just want you to think about that, because as you guys know, there's only so much time and money and resources. And the last question was, it wasn't clear to me when the system starts operating, was all the internal logic and like turning it on and operating on the inside, or was there like a separate computer somewhere running the software?
So during the missions, the system would be completely autonomous.
Okay, but what about doing testing? How did you guys manage?
In testing, because we have the gimbal, we didn't want to have any wires being wrapped around in any like mess. So we, in the testing, we loaded onto the Arduino, our code onto the Arduino, and then we tested that to see what happens. We didn't have anything connected during any of the testing of the satellite.
Okay. Thank you. Good job.
Oh, I stole some of mine. My name is Sarah Hatch. I'm also JPL, Mission Design and Navigation for the Integrated Earth Mission System Office, which is running all of our Earth orbiting satellites that we run through JPL. One thing that I think, and it's not just your project, but the three I've seen so far today, I didn't see a test plan of how this was going to be done throughout the semester, right? So what your plan was, and then obviously as you started marching through it and needed three times longer, you kind of see how you're progressing. So I think that was one thing that, could be added, you know, probably for future presentations. I also think that we probably missed some of the background information that you might have had in your preliminary things from last semester. So yeah, it did take me a minute to kind of get on board with what you were trying to do. Another thing is, you kind of said you didn't want translation during the mission or rotation or anything like that of your base. But to me, that says that you had some notion of what was going on the inside. Since you were different teams of the launcher, spacecraft, and the gimbal, how did you discuss those requirements and how you make sure it doesn't move?
So I'd like to pass this off to our gimbal team to talk about any collaboration between teams.
Yeah, so the satellite also had a requirement for how far, or did it? So the center mass of the satellite being offset could apply certain torques or forces due to centripetal accelerations to through the gimbal to the gimbal base. So we had to estimate how much that would be based on our estimated center of mass offset for the satellite and the gimbal as well. And then so we did have to have an idea of how much that could be based on the mass of the satellite, so we could find out how heavy our gimbal base had to be, or if it had to be anchored down to the ground. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. I guess we didn't see, how you came up with the middle guts, that was part of this presentation. Was that
Okay.
So how did you come up with the middle guts?
So the orientation of kind of what's inside the satellite itself was kind of driven by that need to have a kind of centered center of mass. So for example, the CubeSats are positioned along the central axis of the rotational axis of the satellite. So the reason for that was we wanted to make reduce center mass offsets as much as possible during the rotational part where we're doing the majority of our attitude control and adjustment. And additionally, things like the electronics and the solenoids, we tried to orient them kind of symmetrically as much as we could to kind of keep it kind of centered, just as far as center of mass.
So did you do simulations, like you put this together in whatever program you use, and then did the balance test to confirm what the design is versus the build?
Yes, we did. We did simulations with all of the center mass offsets at at the maximum locations that they were expected that they could be, and found that it numerically validated the requirements. So then we physically tested the center of mass for the gimbals and found that they were within those bounds. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Yeah.
Hi, George Carlo. JPL retired. Also in the same section that serves at Mission Center. I just have one comment observation, and that was with the use of the term system of systems. Okay, so to me, a system is a group of subsystems, and the system is required to, the subsystems work together to achieve the system requirements. And it looked like all of that came up the middle of the presentation with Mr. Burns to give that information. First of all, unless I missed it, I would have moved that summary of the requirements for the system to the beginning of the presentation. I think that would help orient people to what you were trying to do with this whole system. And I guess I'm wondering if a system of systems is a little bit redundant and
So my experience is that the terminology for the subsystems, or the terminology for the systems that make up the system, the overall system, is a subsystem. Is that what you meant, or am I missing some other concept here?
So it always breaks down into the different components or subsystems that are within the systems. But mainly what we were thinking is that because we have two teams working on the satellite and the gimbal, that we'd say this overall thing is a system of systems where each team works on their own system.
Okay, so one of those systems is the gimbal, one of those systems is the satellite itself, one of those systems is the deployment mechanism that you use to eject the CubeSat.
So the gimbal is a system, and the satellite is a system, and those are the only two systems. The launcher is a subsystem within the system.
So stating that up front will also help.
Okay. Sorry about that.
But, yeah, good job.
Thank you.
Hi, good job. Enjoyed the presentation. My name is Zach Cruz. I'm from Oregon NASA Johnson Space Center. I work in human space system simulation. And I had a lot of the points that I was going to cover already been covered, but there was one that came up specifically. You'd mentioned in the attitude determination of this that you were going to be using your solar panels to determine the sun vector.
Yes, sir.
So what was the accuracy that you could determine the sun vector with solar panels?
So I'd like to hand this off to John Mother to talk about the accuracy.
Due to time constraints, we weren't actually able to connect the solar panels and test how accurately we could detect the sun vector, but our requirement stated that we needed to detect it within 7 degrees.
Okay, do you think that you could do that with a set of solar arrays dispersed? I mean, I'm not sure how many faces you've got solar arrays on, but
We have 6 faces with the solar arrays on, 4 along the middle, and each of the end plates have it. We do believe that we could do it based on the algorithm we come up with. We might have to make some modifications, like a little lens to prevent the solar panels from saturating in raw sunlight in general, but we do believe we could get close enough.
As you talked about the simulation that you used, was it a single simulation built in Simulink, or did you have a series of simulations that you used in order to do things like one thing which was to verify the offset that you would be allowed in your gimbal center of mass offset?
So let me pass this off to Gavin Humphrey to talk about our simulation.
Yeah, that was a single simulation in Simulink where we could vary different parameters such as the center mass offsets, the thrust level, so we could find out like if we didn't get the right amount of thrust, or the bearing friction, among other things. So we used that single simulation to numerically validate a lot of these requirements and also find out the balance that it would still work.
Okay, so did you do like a parameter sweep, or were going to assess what the balance should be?
We had like an Excel file where we could just vary different parameters manually.
Awesome. So you had multiple simulations, because the Excel would also be a simulation, or at least a parametric simulation system.
The simulating model just read the values in those constants.
Okay.
Yeah. So we were able to quickly vary those and then run the simulation again and see how it affected the results and see if the mission was still successful.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it does. And the question that I had about you chose as one of your metrics for this the minimum, maximum design launch distance for this. Now, later on in the presentation, you did eventually get to exit velocity. But isn't really the key mission requirement on this really going to be exit velocity that you have from the satellite?
So at the beginning of the project, our mission proposal was to get the satellites to a specified target, and that's how we determine that distance, because that's what we were told. So based on that, we found the needed exit velocity using kinematics. And, not using kinematics for that, but just using some
So you're assuming though that you had it at an attitude that was going to do a 45-degree launch to get the maximum distance.
We had another simulation to determine that. So we built a MATLAB code that varies through the different launch angles, and we can determine the needed required exit velocity from the system in order to reach the target. So based on that, we found the minimum needed exit velocity, and that's the input.